excited to see all of you.
Typically, we would jump right into the song, but yesterday I felt led by the Lord to declare some things over all of us today. Yeah. So the first song that we're singing is Stand in Your Love, and the chorus of that simply says, my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And we're in a time right now in the world where there's a lot of opportunities for fear to take over. Not even just things that are happening in the world, but just things that are happening in our own personal lives that people may not even know about. And so I wanted to read this scripture today. It's 1 John 4:16-18. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. I personally know the torment that fear can bring to your life and to others in your life. This is something that I've worked with Jesus to overcome. And I was raised in church my whole life and was told fear is the opposite of faith. And I'm pretty sure we've all heard that before. But I want to offer you a different vision of that today. Hebrews 11:1 says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Now I'm going to replace that with fear. Now fear is the substance of things we think may happen without seeing evidence that it will happen. So today I just wanted to declare to you that fear is not the opposite of faith. Fear is a form of manipulated faith, making you believe what the enemy is telling you instead of what Jesus already declared over you. So this morning as we sing this song and we get to that part, I want you to declare over yourself, prophesy over yourself, over this church, that we don't have to stand in fear, and that the weight of his love can crush the weight of our fear. Let's worship together.
All right, church, we're gonna sing When Darkness.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain are all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken, 'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. Come on. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. And my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's rest. stand a chance when I stand in your love, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love, and my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Oh, I'm standing in your love.
Amen. Church, if you just bow your heads with me, Heavenly Father, we just thank you for these moments that we just get to share with you, Jesus. And God, I just pray for whatever happened earlier this morning, whatever's going to happen later today, God, I pray that we just meditate right here, right now in this moment with you, Jesus. That these words that we sing, God, they're not just words, they're a relationship with you.
You are breaking new ground. Jesus, bring new wine of relief.
Amen. Bow down before Him. His banner is love over us. His mercies are new every morning, and I'll sing, oh, 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 oh. Let us sing to the Lord. Come, let us bow down before Him. His banner is love over us. His mercies are new.
Thank you.
within me is His holy name. Everything that's in me is His holy name. Everything that's in me is His holy name.
My praise is a weapon.
Everything that's in me.
My praise is a weapon.
Holy name. Everything that's in me. Holy name, everything that's in me, it's His holy name. Everything that's in me, it's His holy name. Everything that's in me,
it's so.
Amen.
Shout out praise.
Come on, can we give Jesus praise this morning? Amen. Amen. You guys are awesome. Y'all can take a seat. So good to be with you this morning. Hope you guys are feeling fantastic. You look fantastic. So that's good. I just wanted to welcome you, say that we're so glad that you're with us, that you've joined us here. A bunch of things that we want you to know about. So turn your attention to the screens and we're going to check out this video.
Good morning and welcome to church, Grace Fellowship Church. My name is Josh Tribble, one of the pastors here at Grace, and I just want to say you are so welcome to church today. We're so glad that you're here. Whether you are here in the church building or you're with us online, we're running about 50-50 right now, and we just want you to know you are part of this family, and we love you, and we're glad that you're worshiping today. Just a couple things that you can be a part of as we go forward into today's service. There is a card that you can fill out. It's called our Connect card, especially if your family is relatively new here and you want to just start to connect in. You can put some of your information on that Connect card. You can get one of those out in our lobby and hand that to the Connect desk. And if you're online, there should be a link down here below that talks about Connect. You click that link, just fill in a little bit of the info. We're not trying to gather your marketing information. Nobody's going to show up at your house or send you letters or anything like that, I promise. All we want to do is just know that you're here and know that you're interested in becoming part of this church family. And if you fill that out in either form, paper or online, we are going to make a donation to a really important ministry. It's called Tender Mercies. We've been partnering with them for a while now. And what they do is we make a donation so that they will feed two families that are in need, two families of four. They'll feed them a meal on your behalf because you filled out this card. They'll get that donation. And since we started this little partnership, we've had 1,884 families fed. Isn't that awesome? Could you give an applause for that today? Because I think that's so awesome. It's right there below 1884 so far. I can't wait till we cross the 2000 number there. Also, on that card, you'll notice there's a spot for you to fill out prayer requests. And this is for all of us. If you would like any of our pastors to be praying for you and your family this week, it's our privilege to take those before God with you. We join with you in prayer. So go ahead and write those things down. Also, you have the ability to give today, to give toward this ministry, to give to the Lord. There's three different ways for you to give. They're also here listed below. First one is our website, gracelawton.org. There's information on how to get giving set up there. Also, you can text to give if that's more your speed. Or in the back of the room, we get these joy boxes back there. There's these black metal boxes, and you can put cash and check in there, and you can give old school if that's more your speed. Couple things that are coming up in future weeks that you can be a part of. Our very next preaching series starts in 2 weeks, and that is called The Third Option. So we're going to tackle a really easy topic called racism. Wow, right? Racism. But we're going to look at this topic, and we're going to ask, what does God say about this topic? What does the Bible say? And I would just tell you that no matter what background you're coming from, what personal philosophy, what political party you might be a part of, we're all going to come to the table together, and we're going to be a family, and we're going to unite under the banner of God's word together and see what it is that he has to say. So it's going to be challenging. It's going to be challenging to all of us, including me. But I really think this is a series that is so important for all of us. It's important for our kids. It's important for friends of yours that might not even be at church right now. This might be a topic that they would want to come to church and hear about. So please be inviting them, be praying over this series. It's a big deal for us. Third Option. We're even going to be selling some books about the Third Option out in the lobby starting today. So if you want to read those and get ahead and just start seeking the Lord on that, go ahead and do that. The next thing I want to tell you about is our baptism class. Next week, we're having a baptism class after our third service, so it's right around the lunch hour. We are going to be serving lunch for the baptism class. Sign up today for that. If you're interested in getting water baptized, come to the class, because we're going to go through the scriptures together on what it means to be baptized and why. The third thing I want to tell you about, and this is the last thing, is we are doing Summer Jam in August. August 5th through the 7th, we're doing Summer Jam, which is our fancy version of VBS, and it's all colors, and it's creative, and it's music, and it's loud, and it's fun, and it's games, and it's awesome. But Summer Jam is a great time. If you've got kids that are going into first grade or even going into fifth grade, that's kind of the window that we're looking for kids-wise, they are welcome at Summer Jam. You can sign them up today, your kids, so that they can be a part of Summer Jam. And for those 3 days, I think we're running from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. If you're curious about the schedule, you can ask more at the information table in the lobby. You can also sign up online. For Summer Jam, also, of course, we need volunteers. So if you're someone that in those windows, even if you can just serve 1 day or 2 days or all 3 days would be great. We would love for you to sign up to volunteer, because we're going to have a mass of kids and we want to keep everybody as safe as we possibly can and having a great time. If you want to be part of this important mission and ministry to our kids, sign up for Summer Jam today. Okay, that's it for announcements. Would you give a hand right now to Pastor Tanner Church as he preaches to us from God's Word today on the topic of purpose? Give him a hand, please.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So good to be with you guys. If you notice, Josh is wearing the same shirt right now that he was in the video. So ask him if he did laundry, and hopefully he's telling the truth, you know? But no, it's so good to be with you. My name is Tanner, one of the pastors here, and as always, such an honor and a privilege to be with you and get to talk out of God's Word. And we are in this series. We're actually ending it today. This is the last series in this sermon called Welcome, or last sermon in this series called Welcome Back to Wholeness. And so excited to be getting to talk about this. This whole series, the whole idea was we're using this recent event that's happened in all of our lives, called quarantine and coronavirus, and this crazy thing that's gone on, and all of us went into quarantine with hopes of doing really well and being disciplined. And I think for a lot of us, myself included, that's how it started, but it's not how it ended. And some things got out of whack, and old habits kind of creep their way back in. And so here we are, and we're talking about welcome back to healthy, welcome back to wholeness, welcome back to all the good things that God has for you. We've talked about community and our relationship with God. And the illustration that we used right at the very beginning of this whole thing was that we're at this red light, you know, figuratively speaking, and it's turned green. Like, there's nothing stopping us anymore from moving forward into what God has for us. And so God is like lovingly tapping the horn, being like, let's go, let's move forward. And so we're wrapping up this conversation today by talking about purpose. Welcome back to purpose. So we're going to pray really quickly, and then we're going to jump in. I'm going to pray for the message for this morning, and I'm also want to lift up the Grace Student Ministry because they're out at camp right now having a good time, so we're going to pray for them too. So let's pray together. Jesus, we love you so much, and Father, we're so, so glad to be here. God, we're thankful to be in this room. God, I thank you for all of the people that are here, God. God, I thank you that you have called all of these people as individuals. God, you have purpose for them. So, God, I'm excited to open up this conversation and talk about this today. God, would you speak to us? God, always our prayer is that we would leave this place different and changed from the way that we came in. God, that you would use your word. God, you're fully aware of what's happening in every single person's life. And God, you know what each person needs to hear. So, God, I pray that you would speak, and God, I pray that we would be listening. God, that our ears would be attentive to what you have to say. God, I lift up our Grace Student Ministry, God, as they're out at camp right now having a great time. God, we pray that they have so much fun. God, that it's memories that they'll have with them for the rest of their life, God. And God, that they'll form a relationship and a bond with you that is strong, God, that will last. God, that they would have moments at camp that are encounters with you that mean so much to them. God, is this such a crucial time in their life, God, that you would use this camp to help them build a solid foundation. God, that they would have an incredible time. Father, we love you so much, and we pray for all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So talking about purpose, okay? Super easy topic, right? It's like it's only the biggest question that every single human being is asked throughout history. Like, why am I here? What's my purpose? What am I supposed to do on this planet? What is my purpose? Every single human being has asked that question. It's the topic and it's the story of every single Disney movie that's ever come out, right? Like my son, his favorite movie right now is Frozen 2. We watch it probably once a day. I've seen it a lot, and if I'm honest, I still don't get it. Like she's the fifth spirit of something, and I don't know, but whatever. But that's what Elsa's trying to do, right? What am I here for? Why do I have this magical power that I can freeze things, you know? What's my purpose? It's the topic of all these movies and all these books. It's the desire in each of us to know, why am I here? What is this all about? And it comes with a bunch of sub-questions that are really stressful. Like, what kind of job should I get? And where should I go to school? What should my major be in school? Who should I marry? When should we have kids? What kind of tattoos should I get? You know what I mean? Like, stressful, real questions. They mess with you. I'm just kidding about the tattoo things. You shouldn't think about tattoos. Just go get them, you know? Just kidding. But they come with these questions like, I want a job that's going to fit my purpose, and I want to be fulfilled, and I want to be married to somebody that's got purpose, and we're going to do so many incredible things together. And so it's this overwhelming question, why am I here? What am I supposed to do? The flip side of it, which is equally as scary, is there any purpose at all? Like, is this all just random? Is this some kind of weird accident? Is there any purpose? Or are we just here and then we die, and so let's just do whatever we want to do because we're here, you know? And let's have a good time. Let's be nice to each other, you know? But is there a reason? Is there a purpose? Or is this just whatever? Is this just some sort of accident and we're all here together? That's the first thing that I want to go after today, and I want us to make sure that we all know you are here for a purpose. God has designed you and created you to do something. You've been placed in this time in history in order to accomplish something that he has for you. There's no mistakes. You are not a mistake. You are not an accident. You are not random. You are intentionally, purposefully made by God to do something. He's got a plan and a purpose for you. Some verses here that I think are really cool. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9 says this, "But you are not like that," talking about people living in a way that's contrary to what God would want. "You are not like that, for you are a chosen people. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of darkness into his wonderful light." You are a chosen people. Chosen, that's such a powerful word. God picked you. God knows you. God's chosen you, and you're made for something. He's got a plan and a purpose for you. The book of Jeremiah says that before you formed me in my mother's womb, you knew me. So important. Two super cool things. Your parents make you, but God formed you. God's put into you passion, and he's put into you talents, and he's put into you desire. He's put into you your personality. God has formed you. So, so cool. So you're not random. God has chosen you. He's made you as you are. Ephesians chapter 2, Verse 10, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. You're God's masterpiece. Again, it's no accident. It's no mistake. You are fearfully and wonderfully made, the Bible says. Again, with intention, with purpose, I've got something for you. You're a masterpiece to God. And in the second half of that verse, so that you can do the good things he planned for you. Like, it's not like you showed up and God was like, I need to find a job for you. No, he's planned it. Like, you were coming over for dinner, he ordered pizza, you know? He was ready. And so he's got a purpose and a plan for you, and he's prepared it. So you're chosen by God. You're a masterpiece. And he's got good things planned for you from long ago. Before the foundations of the earth, he knew you, he chose you, and he said, I've got something for them to do in the time that I've put them in history. So, so important. Are you an accident? Is this random? No. God has a purpose. You are here for a purpose. So what is the purpose, right? Why are we here? What's going on? How can we figure this out? We're going to read a verse, Colossians 1, 15 through 20. It's going to seem like sort of maybe like a right turn for a second, but really, really important for us to frame this conversation. And so Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 through 20 says, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead. So he is the first in everything, for God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. Such a great verse, and this chunk of scripture, so powerful. And if I could sum it up in like Tanner's version of the Bible, it's that Jesus is awesome, right? He's awesome, and he's ultimate. He's supreme. Everything is created in him, through him, for him. He's holding everything together. It's all, he's over everything, supreme, ultimate. So when it comes to your life and my life, why are we here? What's my purpose? What do I want to do? The most meaningful that my life can be and the most meaningful that your life can be is when we partner with Jesus, because he is that great. And everything was created through him, for him, by him. He's holding this all together. And so if I want to be impactful, if I want to do something in life that's meaningful and I want to be a part of something bigger than myself, the place that I go is Jesus, because that's who Jesus is. And so when Jesus is asked the question, what should we do? What's the most important thing for us to do? Somebody comes to Jesus and he asks, you know, teacher, what's the greatest commandment? Like, what are we supposed to do? What's the most important thing for us? And this is what Jesus says, Matthew 22, 37 through 40. Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. So two for the price of one, right? Jesus is super generous, you know? Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. Jesus, what's the most important thing for us to do? What's our purpose? What's the greatest thing that we can be involved with here in this life? And he says, simply, it's to love God and it's to love people. This is the purpose for every single human being on the planet throughout history, is to love God and love people. If you've wondered your whole life, what's my purpose? What am I supposed to be doing? It's love God and it's love people. And that's awesome. And if you're like me, you go, that's so cool. I don't know what that means, though. And it feels maybe like sort of spiritual. And like, I love God. I think he's great, you know, and I love people. Like, there are some people that annoy me, but I don't show it on my face. So that's nice to them, right? Like, I'm being loving. I love God. I love people. I think I'm doing pretty well. So what does this mean? How do we walk this out? All of us have passions and all of us have skills and desires. And okay, I want to do something. How do I partner that with love God, love people? What's this all about? Two things that I think are going to help us so much, two kind of roads that we're going to go down to look at this. So number one, your purpose is happening right now. Like, what you are designed and created to do is right in front of you. And it starts off really broad, right? Like, we have this phrase, love God, love people. And that could mean all sorts of things. It's super huge, and that's on purpose. And so we're going to look at a verse. This is Zechariah 4:10. So, so important. And this is, I think, one of the most powerful truths that we're going to learn this morning. Zechariah 4:10 says this. Do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin, to see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hand. So Zerubbabel is this guy in Zechariah. He's building a building, and so he's got the plumb line, you know, to get it started. And God's using this as an illustration, going, I love this moment, when it looks like nothing. And it's the beginning. And so he says, don't despise the day of small beginnings. Don't look at this with contempt, like, I'm excited about this thing. So I want to look at the life of King David for a second. We've kind of talked about him every single week, not on purpose. He's just got a lot of story, you know. He's got a lot to learn about his life. So we're going to look at him again and what I think this don't despise the day of small beginnings means and how it fits with our purpose. So David, he's a young guy. In his teens, he's a shepherd, right, looking after the sheep. That's his job. And David has this moment as a young man where the prophet Samuel comes over to his house and he's looking for the next king, looks at all of David's brothers. None of them are the right guy. And he sees David and God's like, yes, that's him. That's the future king of Israel. There he is. So David's anointed king right there as this teenage guy. But he doesn't become king for a really long time. And so here's David, still a shepherd. It's important to see him there out in the fields after being anointed king. And I imagine David could have had the attitude of, this is stupid. I hate these sheep. They're dumb. They smell, you know, and they're running off. Like sheep, if you've ever known sheep, sheep are just trying to die. Like that's what they do. They're just, you know, it's like so annoying to keep a sheep alive, you know. So here, he could be like, I'm supposed to be king, you know. Samuel said I was going to be king, and I want to be king right now. And these sheep are dumb, and I hate being here. David could have had that attitude. David does not have that attitude. And David decides, I'm going to be the best shepherd that I can be right now. And I'm going to look at this thing in front of me that seems small and seems insignificant, and I'm going to say, I'm going to do the best that I can. And David does not despise the day of small beginnings, but he says, I'm going to care for and protect these sheep. And that's what I'm going to do right now. This is how I'm going to start. I'm going to start with something small like these sheep, and I'm going to love, and I'm going to care, and I'm going to protect them. And so when a lion comes, I would leave, you know, that I would not choose to fight the lion. But when a lion comes, he decides, no, I'm going to fight that lion and kill that lion to protect my sheep. And then when a bear comes, I was mountain biking one time in Durango, Colorado, just on the single track by myself, and I hear some rumbling to my right, and a huge bear just runs right in front of me across the track. It's the fastest I've ever rode a bike in my life, you know? I was exhausted. Like, bears are scary, and he sees a bear coming to attack his sheep, and he says, instead of running away, I'm going to go kill that bear to protect these sheep. It's the kind of shepherd that David is. I'm going to do the best that I can right here, right now with what's in front of me. I'm not going to despise this thing, but I'm going to be about it. I'm going to go for it. I'm going to do the best that I can. And so David's story sort of continues. God sees that moment, sees that he's faithful with this small thing. And so David's story continues. He becomes a pretty prominent guy in Israel's story. And he's this really incredible warrior. And he becomes such an incredible warrior and such a famous person that the king at the time, Saul, really doesn't like him and thinks he's kind of trying to steal his thunder, you know. So he hates David. So David's on the run. And David gets this entourage of these dudes around him in this time. And they're called David's Mighty Men. And they're a bunch of rough dudes. They're convicts and crazy guys. And like they're rough, rough guys. In 2 Samuel chapter 23, it lists all of these dudes by name, and it lists all of the things that they've done. Like, the first guy it lists is, like, he killed 800 people at one time. Like, that is a lot of people to kill at once, you know? Like, that's a lot. And then there's another guy named Benaiah, and it's like, he's done some stuff, but then one day, he chased a lion into a pit on a snowy day. Like, what have you done with your free time, you know? He's like, I got 20 minutes to spare. I'm going to chase that lion into a pit. It's snowing. I don't care. You know, we're going to do, like, that's who these guys are. Rough dudes, okay? And here's these guys, 37 of them. Lists them all by name. Lists them all by the exploits that they've been a part of. Why does it do that? It does that because David knows all of those guys by name. David knows all of those guys. He knows their stories. What's David do? I'm in this crazy spot in my life. Again, I could be frustrated. I'm supposed to be king. I'm on the run. I'm living in caves. This is not the life that was promised to me. David doesn't do that. David looks at the 37 guys right here and goes, I'm going to love them. I'm going to protect them. I'm going to care for them. These are my people now. And these people have been entrusted to me, so I'm going to pour myself into these relationships. I'm going to get to know them on an individual level. And so he was faithful as a shepherd with these sheep. I'm going to protect, and I'm going to care. And God took that, said, yes, that's what I want you to have. And he narrowed the focus of David's life. Okay, you've got care and you've got protection. I need you to get that. And now David's got individual care. I know you. I see you. I'm going to care for you. You're not just a group of 37 guys to me. I know you all by name. You're not just here to protect me. Like I care about you. And so God narrows the focus of David's life again, and now David is king. Now David's sitting here, and he's at the spot. He's living in the purpose that God called him to so long ago. But God has used all of these moments, all of these small beginnings in David's life. And David said, I'm not going to despise these days of small beginnings. I'm not going to look at these things with annoyance, but I'm going to jump in and I'm going to say, I'm going to do the best that I can. And God takes that and God narrows the focus of David's life until he's a king who's living in his purpose, which is to care for and protect people in his nation and to lead them as individuals. He knows people. It's not just some number to David. But he's been learning, and God's been narrowing the focus of his life. And so here's David living in his purpose. I'm going to care for and protect the nation of Israel. I'm going to lead them, not like other kings. There's a lot of kings in Israel's history. Looked at them like a number. Looked at them as like disposable people. David's, no, I'm not like that. Like, I see you. I know you. I'm going to care for and I'm going to protect you. So now David is living in his purpose. And God took this broad thing, this love God, love people beginning, and here's some sheep. And he took that and he said, okay, I'm going to narrow this down for you. And you're going to come to each step. And if you come to each step with this sense of, I'm going to do what's in front of me the best that I can, God narrows the focus of your life. So I thought about my own story, you know. I'm looking at David and seeing what God did through him and how God took his purpose to this place of caring for and protecting these people in his nation. Well, you know, I kind of want to, like, think about this for myself, you know. So I thought about my freshman year of college, Cam, 18, and I'm at Fort Lewis College in Durango, Colorado, and I'm on my own now, you know? I'm a man. There's no consequences. Yes, there are. But, here I am. There's no parents. I'm living on my own, and I'm going to do whatever I want. I've been a Christian my whole life, you know? I'd gone to youth group every Sunday night, went to church every Sunday morning, and, like, that was my life. And so here I am, and kind of, you know, I'm on my own, and let's see what kind of person I am. And started hanging out with these guys. It's like my second day. It's freshman orientation. So I hang out with these guys, and they're like they're idiots. You know what I mean? Like, they're not the sharpest tool in the shed. So some of my friends lived in this dorm room called Snyder Hall. So I went in to go hang out with some of my friends, and there's this guy sitting in the lobby, and he's got ink and a needle, and he's prison tattooing into his calf the word Snyder Hall. I'm like, you will regret this, dude. Like, your son's going to be like, Dad, what's that saying? You're saying, it says regret, dude. You know what I mean? Like, he's sitting there diligently tattooing this word into his calf. So these are my friends, right? World changer kind of people, you know? And so I'm with these guys one day, and again, we're like 3 days in, and we're kind of walking around the campus, and one of the guys goes, hey, do you want to go on a mission trip to Africa? And I was like, now? Like, we don't have time, bro. Like, that's a lot of money. Africa's far away. And I'd learned quickly that going on a mission trip to Africa was code word for these dudes to let's go in the woods and smoke some weed, okay? We're going to go on a mission trip to Africa. And I don't know, it's not an effective code word because nobody thinks that's what you're actually doing. So it's like, it's not working. But so I hiked through the woods with these guys. I've never smoked weed in my life. And I'm like, okay, you know, let's see what happens here. And we get to this place in the woods, and they'd built with chain link fence with blankets thrown over top and four couches and a table on the inside, okay? So whoever says stoners are lazy, these guys were about it, you know what I mean? They were like, if I'm gonna do this, I wanna be comfortable, you know? So here we are sitting in our fort, and they start passing, you know, this thing around, and pre-COVID days, obviously the germs, disgusting, right? Like, you're passing this thing around, you're all putting your mouths on it, it's horrible. Gets to me. I'm like, okay, you know, here we go. And my phone rings right then. And this guy that I'd met my very first day at a young adult ministry called Zach got my phone number. And he called me right then. He said, "Hey, bro, I was thinking about you just now. I'm making some brownies at my house. You want to come over?" And I'm sitting there with my phone and the bong. And I'm like, yes, I do want to come over, you know? I'm in a weird place right now. So I get to his house. I'm like, dude, you have no idea what you just saved me from, you know? And it's this dumb story, but it's this moment for me of looking at God going, I see you, and I want to save you from that, from, you know, tattooing the word Snyder Hall on your calf. I've got better things for you. And so it's this moment where I got super pumped about ministry. I got pumped about church, and oh my gosh, I was in. Like, God saw me in that moment. He's close to me. He knows me. And so I was like, I'm going to jump in. I'm going to be a part of this church, you know? And the thing that was there, the thing that was available, was they needed a worship leader for their young adult ministry. And I'd played guitar and I'd sang, but I'd never done worship stuff before. And I was like, okay, I'll do that. You know, it's what's right there. So God, in that moment, sort of narrowed the focus of my life. You do this thing that's right here. And so I did that and got really involved with this church, and I was an intern, and then I went to Hillsong College in Australia, and it was Bible college, and God narrowed the focus, and okay, like ministry and being a part of church, that's a part of who you are. And it was at Hillsong that I got really, really excited about, like, Hillsong's a big church, like they have their huge campus, but then they have a bunch of little ones all over the place, these churches that are like 150, 200 people. And I got really, really passionate about those churches. About the ones that they were like in an auditorium in just like a random building, and they had to set up and tear down every single Sunday. And there's 100 people in the room. And okay, I loved being there, and God sort of awakened this thing of like, you like to build things. Like there's you want to build something that's healthy, and you want to be a part of growing something. And I'm like, okay, that's awesome. That's a part of who I am. And so then it was the same thing. When I got married, it was like, okay, I want to build a strong, healthy marriage. I want to build a strong, healthy family. And then Kobe Edwards, this tall guy from Lawton, Oklahoma, calls Sarah and I, and do you want to be a part of this church in Lawton, Oklahoma? And here's what we need. Here's the positions, you know? And it was like, yes, because it was a part of the purpose that God had given me of go build something. Go be a part of something that you can contribute to and build into. And so here I am living in Lawton, Oklahoma, in the most like impassioned, fulfilled spot in my life so far. And so God is still narrowing the focus of my life. I'm only 26. He's not like, here you are, you arrived. But he's narrowing the focus for me. He's saying, part of who you are, part of who I've made you to be, is you're somebody that builds things. You're a builder. You're going to build church. You're going to build your family. So this is what God did. So God took David on a journey and said, your purpose is to lead and care for and protect this nation of people, not to think about them like a number, but to see them as individuals. And he took me on this purpose of going, your purpose is to build healthy things, build church, build family, build relationships. If I get fired tomorrow from this job, don't. Please. If I get fired from this job tomorrow, is my purpose over? No. My purpose has never been this job. My purpose has been to build into church. And so I will accomplish that wherever and however I can. God is going to take you on a journey. What is in front of you right now? What is the thing that's right there? You've got dreams. I want to be a part of that. And I see myself being in this industry. I see myself accomplishing all of these big, wonderful things. That's awesome. Go after that. But what's in front of you right now? What's the thing that right now looks annoying? Like, I don't want to deal with this. And this seems like I want to just get through it so I can get on to bigger and better things. What is that thing? And do it the best that you can. Because God is seeing that. He's going, I love the day of small beginnings. I love to see something start. And I have a purpose and a plan for you, but it starts right here. Love God, love people. How are you going to do that? What can you get involved with right now? What's in front of you? Like, think about it. What is it? Your family's in front of you right now. Like, your spouse, your kids, siblings. Invest into them. Love them. Your job is in front of you right now. You know, like, a lot of people are, I'm unfulfilled in my job. I want to move on to something. That's a good desire, to be fulfilled in your work. Absolutely. I'm not saying just suck it up. But what I am saying is, God might like want you to learn something in this job. And so instead of just being annoyed with whatever's in front of you, be all about it. And I'm going to do this the best that I can. And God's going to teach me something here. And he's going to go, that's what I wanted you to get. And now let's narrow the focus of your life. And let's move on. And I'm going to show you your purpose. Do not despise the day of small beginnings, because God loves a small beginning. Think about, God started with a baby. Jesus, right? That is a small beginning. That is like, that's as small as it gets. Like I just, it's like Sarah and I just had a baby. She's 3 weeks old. She's beautiful. But it's like, that's really small. And like you think about Beck and you're like, who are you gonna become? What are you gonna be? And here's Jesus, this baby. He's gonna save the entire world forever. But look at how it started. God loves the small beginning. Don't despise the day of small beginnings because that is how God gets you to what you need to do. Number two of the things that we need to know about purpose. God knows you. God knows who you are. God is fully aware of everything that makes up who you are because he put those things in you. Again, back to the beginning of the message, you're not an accident. This isn't random. This is on purpose. God's placed desire and passion in you. God knows who you are. And when we talk about purpose, what happens a lot of the time is a purpose, and people start saying things like, my purpose is to be a missionary in the Philippines, and I'm going to reach unreached people groups for Jesus, you know? And then somebody's like, I'm going to be a doctor, and I'm going to save lives, you know? They're like, I'm going to be a teacher, and I'm going to mold the minds of children, you know? Like, I'm going to be a part of something. I'm going to be a counselor and heal marriages. And those are awesome things. Don't get me wrong. Those are incredible. And if you're a doctor or a missionary in the Philippines, first off, welcome to Grace Fellowship Church. We're glad you're here. But those things are awesome. But then there's always the person in the room that's like, I want to be an electrician. I want to be a bond trader. Love that, you know? I love, like, that's just like, I get that, you know, I feel good at that. But then you hear all this and you're like, but that's purpose, being a missionary. So you start to wonder, does God give purpose to some people and not to others? Like, he's got purpose, but also he needs electricity, so you need to be an electrician. You know, like, are there classes of purpose? Some's better than others? Like, what do we do here? How do we live out our purpose when it seems like what we want to do is like kind of a small thing? So the truth is, there are no small things. And God's going to look at a missionary, and he's going to look at an electrician and say, I've got purpose for both of you, and it's love God, love people. It doesn't matter how you do it. You can preach to a crowd of 1,000 people at once, or you can preach to one person every day for 1,000 days, and you've both preached to 1,000 people. Why do we elevate one so much higher above the other? We're both doing what God created us to do. So I want to read a verse, Colossians 3:17. Colossians 3:17 says this, and whatever you do, in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Whatever you do, whatever is huge, right? Whatever you do in word or deed, do it all for Jesus. When it comes to purpose in our life, whatever you do, purpose is never a job. Purpose is never an occupation. That's never been your purpose. Your purpose is to love God, love people. And you have the incredible opportunity to be able to take what you're good at and partner love God, love people with that. Lynn Johnson sitting right here. This is Lynn. He's the man, okay? Love Lynn Johnson. He's an incredible guy. And he has a carpet cleaning business, among other businesses, but that's one of them, a carpet cleaning business. And when I first moved to Lawton, Oklahoma, Sarah and I, we got here. We had this little rent house right behind Chick-fil-A. Those were great days. We could walk to Chick-fil-A. Oh. And he came over and he cleaned our carpets, you know? And we're sitting in our front, or standing in our front yard. We weren't sitting, because then we'd be sitting on the ground. But we're standing in the front yard, and he's telling me about, I gave this company to God a long time ago. This is God's carpet cleaning company, and I'm just here to do, you know, I'm here to glorify Jesus through cleaning carpets. Like, what a guy, you know? Is Lynn's purpose in life to be a carpet cleaner? No. That's not his purpose. That's not what God created him to do, is clean carpets. God created him to love God, love people. And he said, here's what I'm good at. Here's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to bring love God, love people into that. And I am living out my purpose. And I'm going to people's houses talking about, this is God's company. This is God's thing. And I'm here to help and I'm here to serve. The guy that came in and installed my internet, okay, works for Fidelity, came over to put my internet in. You also have Fidelity. I love it. The same guy, you know what I'm talking about. And all he talked about was Jesus. That was it for 30 minutes while he was there. I was a missionary, and I'm pumped about all this stuff. And it got to the time to, like, get my password. And he's like, what should your password be? How about Jesus Rocks, you know? How about John 3:16? And I was like, it's a little on the nose for me. I don't know, like, you know, but whatever. And but this guy, is his purpose in life to work for Fidelity? No. But he has said, whatever I can do, I'm going to do that for Jesus. And so I'm going to go to one house at a time and set up internet and love God and love people. And I'm going to talk to people about Jesus. And some people might get annoyed, but some people, it's going to impact them. Let me tell you, the people that do whatever for Jesus, that's how we change the world. That's how a church in Lawton, Oklahoma can accomplish things that nobody thought we could accomplish. Who says we can't do incredible things? Who says we can't have an impact on this world when we are whatever you do kind of people? When it comes to purpose, why has God put us here? Why has God put you here? And I can't answer all of that right now, but I know God's put you here to love God and love people. And I know that when you don't despise the day of small beginnings and you look at this thing that's in front of you, and if you say, I'm going to do this the best that I can, and I'm going to trust that God's going to narrow the focus of my life into a place where I am living in the purpose that he made me for, that he created me for. If you're a whatever I do kind of person, I don't care what the job is, I'm going to love God and love people through this job. Then you can change the world with that. You're going to change somebody's world with that. This whole series, Welcome Back to Wholeness, right? We want to be healthy. We want to be in the best place in life. We want to feel whole. The healthiest, best place that you and I can be is when we're living in the purpose that God created for us. When we're doing what he wanted us to do. That is wholeness. That is where we're supposed to be. And so I'm excited, as just a person thinking about this and preparing this message, excited for us as a church, if we're a church of people just living out this calling of love God, love people, and don't despise the day of small beginnings, and look at what's in front of you, and pour into it, and go after it. What kind of healthy families could we have in this church? What kind of incredible workers could we have all throughout Lawton, Fort Sill, that you just do your job so well, and people look at you and go, you're like, what is it? What's different about you? And you're like, I'm not despising the day of small beginnings, and I'm going to do whatever I can do. I'm going to love God, and I'm going to love people. And I'm going to do the job the best that I can. What happens when that happens? So much. God loves that when something is starting. And so what's in front of you? What are you a part of? How can you bring love God, love people into what you do? And you're going to be operating in God's purpose for your life, and he's going to narrow the focus of your life into what he's called you to do. Amen? Amen. Can we stand up? We're going to pray together. Let's pray. Jesus, we love you so much. God, we're so grateful that you're with us. God, we thank you that you're constant through everything in life. God, you never have a bad day, and you're not in the mood to talk. God, you're here with us right now. And God, you have created us for a purpose. God, you've given us talents and passions and gifts. And God, you've put purpose in our hearts. God, we know we're created to do something. And that's put there by you. And so God, what we're going to do right now is we're going to trust you. And God, we're going to look at the thing that's in front of us right now. Whatever it may be, however small it looks, and we're going to trust that it's actually a huge deal to you. And we're going to do it the best that we can. And we're going to be faithful, and we're not going to despise the day of small beginnings, but we're going to run full force into what you have for us. And God, we're going to trust that whatever we do, when we partner with you, when we partner with Jesus, that you are going to change things in our life and in the lives of others. And God, that we're going to be a people that is operating in purpose, operating in what you designed and created us to do. God, help us to have a sense that you want us for things. God, you've planned things for us. Jesus, we love you. And God, we're going to worship you and we're going to praise you right now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're going to worship one more time with each other. There are prayer teams in the back of the room over here. If you want prayer, please go see them. But we're going to worship.
that's in me, that's His holy name. Everything that's in me,
I bless,
that's His holy name. Everything that's in me,
come on,
that's His holy name. Everything that's in me, bless His holy name. Everything that's in me, bless His holy name. Everything that's in me,
whoa,
bless His holy name. Everything that's in me, bless His holy name.
And so we lift You high, forever lift You high, high within our hearts, high within our minds. Jesus, You alone, our rock, our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our minds. And so we lift You high, forever lift You high, high within our hearts, high within our minds. Jesus, You alone, our rock, our cornerstone, high within our hearts, high within our minds.
Amen. Amen. Well, church, thank you so much for joining with us. We hope to see you next week. You guys have a great rest of your week.